Good morning, everyone. I hope you all have a great conference. So thank you for being here today, and thank you for coming to this session. So I'm Albert Groteboer, and I'm going to talk about how we can implement ChatOps by using the Microsoft Power Platform. So quick introduction by myself. Like I said, I'm Albert Groteboer, and I come from Netherlands. I work at a company called Motion10. And so at Motion10, we basically focus on everything Microsoft. So myself, I focus mostly on Azure, Power Platform, those kind of things. We also work with Office 365, data analytics, all those kind of things. And so basically we work with a lot of my things around Microsoft. I'm also an Azure MVP, so I love working with the community. So that's of course why I'm here today. I also do a lot of writing, books, blogs. I speak a lot, so thank you for that. And you can always contact me on my Twitter. So if you have any questions, any remarks, just reach out to me. And with that, let's have a look at ChatOps. So first we're going to have a look, okay, what is ChatOps? So ChatOps is really all about the conversation-driven development. So you're in a chat room where your team members can type commands that the chatbot then executes. And through those commands, it basically executes scripts and plugins. So for example, doing code deployments, responding to events, notifying team members. So in short, it's about talking to a chatbot, executing commands, and while you execute those commands, actually working with your DevOps experience. So ChatOps is about this conversation-driven collaboration. So it's really about talking to that chatbot and actually have a conversation going on. So it's not just saying a command, but it's really about saying, okay, I want to do this, can you do this for me? I want to do that, can you do that for me? And actually the chatbot coming back to you, saying, okay, if you want to do this, please give me this information. Or are you sure that you want to do this? So there's actually a conversation going on. And so you can actually take actions by interacting with the chatbot. So I can say, okay, start a deployment for me, or please create a ticket for me, or please create a resource for me. And we'll actually do this in the behind the scenes by executing the right scripts and automating this away for me. And so ChatOps is basically an evolution of DevOps. So you have the whole lifecycle of your DevOps experience. So you think of something, you build something, you deploy it to production, you monitor it, you might find something, and then you think about the next thing and just continue to go like this. And ChatOps is really the evolution of this. So you have your DevOps experience, but then doing this DevOps experience by using a chatbot interface. So why should we use ChatOps? First of all, it provides a much simpler UI to our users. So no matter who our user is, they just go to the same experience, in our case, Teams, and they just use Teams and by just chatting to this bot, and they just use Teams as their UI for all the commands. And it automates away all the work. So if I say create a resource for me, I don't have to know how to create a resource in Azure. I don't have to know about naming conventions. I don't have to know about the best practice of setting up this resource. I just say create a resource and I get back, okay, your resource is created. Same for creating tickets and all the other things that we are going to see today. And it provides visibility into what's happening in my environment, because it actually allows me to see, okay, what are others doing? What is happening in my environment? Which resources are being created? Which tasks are being created? So I can actually see what's going on because we're all using the same experience. And so we are going to use the Microsoft Power Platform to actually implement ChatOps. And the Microsoft Power Platform, of course, consists of four different pieces. So we have Power BI for our business analytics. We have Power Apps for our low-code application development. We have Power Automate for our low-code process automation. And we have Power Virtual Agents, with which we can actually create intelligent virtual agents or bots. So how is the Power Platform going to help us empower our ChatOps? First of all, by using those virtual agents, by using those virtual agents, I can actually interact with the human language. So I can actually just talk to my chatbot as I would talk to a person, and it will understand what I'm trying to say. So I don't have to memorize which specific sentences I have to say. I can just say something like, hey, can you create me a ticket? Or please create a ticket for me. So I can use different sentences, but it will understand, okay, if you're saying this, you're probably trying to do this. By using Power Automate, we can actually automate our processes. And like I just said before, ChatOps is really about that automation. And Power Automate is one of the most important parts in here because it's a lot of out-of-the-box connectors to basically connect to different services, different experiences, and actually execute those commands that we want to execute. And the Power Platform actually allows us to get our data where we need it. So if our data in this case is going to be in Dataverse, and there's this is very easy to interact with the whole Power Platform. So I can just get my data from where it is, or if my data is living somewhere else, I can use Power Automate to connect to that. I can react to our environment. Once again, Power Automate allows us to actually react to this. So I can actually get a notification and start something on this. And finally, we can gain better insights by using Power BI for our reports and using the Power Apps to actually create nice low-code apps that we can then use to quickly search over our data. And with that, let's actually go over to some demos, because I think ChatOps is best explained through demos. And the first demo we are going to see is about task management. And we all know about these tasks, right? Like we have all been in an agile environment where we are going to put sticky notes maybe on a physical whiteboard, or more often like something like Azure DevOps, where we actually have a digital whiteboard and we are all pushing out notes there. We are assigning tasks to each other. We are picking up those tasks, doing the work, and then closing those tickets. So how can our ChatOps actually help on this? So first of all, it allows us to acknowledge and assign those issues from this one interface in Teams in our case, and say, okay, I want to create a ticket, I want to assign a ticket, all those kind of tasks. But it does more than that. ChatOps actually allows us, in our case, to actually set up a Git repository. Like, so we already have a Git repository, but a Git branch. So if I create a task, we are going to automate setting up a branch. And this way, my developer actually can just focus on the important things, like actually implementing this work, instead of all the administration around it, like creating those Git branches. And once my Git is actually set up, I'm going to implement my work, of course. And once my work is done, I'm going to create a pull request as a developer. And so this pull request then comes back to my Teams environment, in my ChatOps environment. And then my lead developer or my manager will get a notification like saying, hey, there's something going on. Can you please look at this? They then can approve this from their Teams environment, and this way can actually just use ChatOps to make their life much easier. And finally, because we are all working in the same environment, we can actually see which pull requests are coming in, what people are working on, because we're all working here and we all log in this to the same environment. So let's have a look at that task management. And what I'm going to start with is actually to go into my user view. Actually, I need to have this one. So my user view, and the user will just go to their Teams environment. So as a user, I can now say, for example, get my open task. So I want to see which tasks I have open at the moment, so I know what I can work on today. Please get my open task. As a user, I'm just going to say, okay, please get me open task. Oh, actually, so let me just check. Can please get me my task. So get me my task. Right. There we go. So now it's going to get my task. It's going to say, okay, how many tasks would you like? So let's get the top 10 tasks. It's now going out to Power Automate to my Azure DevOps environment, and it's just going to check, okay, which open tasks do you have? And so this is getting my open tasks, and as you can see, I got these 10 top. I've got more, so there's some more in there that we'll see later on. I can now say, okay, I'm going to work on one of these. Or I could actually say, I'm going to create a work item. Let me just check, what was the work item, that's one. There we go. So please create a new work item in this case. And now it's coming back to me like, okay, if you want to create a work item, I have to have some information from you. As you can see, I'm not just talking to this bot, and it's actually coming back to me with questions. So let's go create a task. So the title, let's just push date for this. So 13/05/2021. So this will be easy to recognize later on. I will have to provide a description. So update the README file, because I know there's an issue with my README file in this case. And it's now going to actually create this task in Azure DevOps, and it's coming back to me like saying, okay, this will be your ID. Now, I got my ID 201 over here. So if I now go back, go over to my Azure DevOps environment over here, refresh, I actually have this item here. Now, as a developer, I can now pick up this item. So as a developer, I could now pick this up, say, okay, so what's in here? And as you can see, I now see that I now have to create, update the README file, but also have this branch already. So as a developer, I can now just click on this branch. it immediately goes to my branch. So again, I just work on this. I can say I want to do some work. And what we are going to change actually here, chat oops should of course be chat ops. So I now as a developer, I'm doing my changes. I'm going to commit this to my branch. This of course is a very simple one. Normally I would probably have some more work than this, but for this demo, this is fine. So you're going to create a pull request. So I'm just going to say compare my branch, merge this into main. Save it, read me. I'm going to create a pull request. And as soon as I create a pull request, if I go back to over here, if I go over to my Teams environment, when I create the pull request, it will actually give a pop-up saying, hey, there's a new pull request for you. Now, as a lead developer or as a manager, I can now view this pull request. So I can have a look, okay, what actually was changed. So I see, okay, so they changed this. That's fine. I can then go back over to my Teams environment. I can now either reject it, saying, okay, this was not right, or I can merge this, say, okay, this is now okay, and please merge this for me. And this is now getting merged in behind the scenes. As you can see, it's now approved, it's merged, and we're done. And, oh, sorry, that was the wrong. So over here, when I go to my pull request, if I refresh this, it's merged, and I can now say, okay, delete this branch. So this is the view from the user. So now let's look behind the scenes. Because of course, behind the scenes, you are doing a lot of stuff for this. So if I go over here, first of all, I use a Power Virtual Agents to actually have this chatbot experience. And what you will see is I have two different topics for this, but the first one is actually going to get my task. As you can see, I've got some different questions over here, but there's not actually the one that I was asking, like, please get me my task. So because it's using machine learning, and if I provide more trigger phrases, it will actually get smarter. But if I just provide it a lot of different trigger phrases, it actually learns like, okay, so phrases that look like this probably want to start this specific flow. It then, once the flow started, come back to me like, okay, how many tasks would you like to retrieve? I said 10. And then it's going out to my Power Automate. And my Power Automate then goes out. Let me just show you. Refresh. So this one we just ran. So in my Power Automate, what you will see, so it has this input from my virtual agent, so it had amount of 10, and then goes out, it's the nice variables, and then goes out to my Azure DevOps. So I got my Azure DevOps, it selected my top 10 fields, it created a nice HTML table out of this and returned this. And this is very easy to set up because actually this is all low code. So I don't actually have to write anything. I can just use the out-of-the-box connectors. I just say, okay, please provide this for me. And as you can see, this is all configuration. So I don't have to know how to work with the Azure DevOps API or something like that. It's just all configuration and I don't actually have to write any code for this. So this is really easy for anyone to set up. I can just say which values do I want. I can just say, okay, from this output, create a HTML table, and I then return this. And then this was, of course, given back to my actual ChatOps environment. So that was the first one. The second one, where we actually were saying, okay, create a work item. Same kind of flow. I had those buttons I could pick because I have a multiple option over here. Like, it just goes through the flow with different questions. And then it tells me, okay, I'm going to go out to another flow, Power Automate flow. And in this one, I'm going to create a work item. So I'm just going to create all the use all the input, create a work item. But then I also got, like I said, okay, get me my branch, my main branch, create a new branch, name it according to my title of my work item, update this work item, and just put this branch location in there. As you can see, I'm already automating a lot of stuff here so that my developer actually doesn't have to do that work for himself. And of course, I could do much more over here. So this is just a demo, but in real life, I could do many more tasks just to make sure that my developer actually can focus on the important work instead of all this administration. So that was the first demo. So we have now seen how we can create work items. Let's have a look at the second demo, because creating work items is okay, but not that exciting. The second one is a bit more exciting, I think. Actually creating resources with self-service portal. So, and this actually allows us to our users to say, okay, I want to have a database. I want to have a virtual machine. I want to have a storage account. I want to have whatever. Normally, I would go to my ticket system, for example, Jira or Topdesk or something like that. I would create a ticket saying, I want to have this resource. It will go out to my operations team. At some point, they will pick this up. They will come back to me like, okay, you did not provide all the information, so we need this, this, and this. I would then provide the information. At some point, they will pick it up again. At some point, they are going to actually deploy this. And after a couple of hours to days, I will probably have my resource. Now, of course, when we are working with an agile environment, we don't want to wait hours or days. We just want to have this quickly. So how does ChatOps help here? First of all, ChatOps allows us to have much quicker allocation of those resources. So instead of hours or days, I just have to wait minutes. It allows for increased transparency because I can actually see which resources I can create. And I can just pick one of those and just get this done. And actually place use in control because users can just say, I want to have a new database. But it still maintains governance for my operations team because my operations team is actually going to build the templates that has all the best practices in there, all the different things that you need to think about, all the security. So even as a user, I don't know which security I need to use, which are the best practices. I can just say, create a database for me. And all those best practices are still incorporated in this. And once again, as a user or as an operations person, I can actually focus my time on the important tasks instead of all these menial tasks that I don't really want to spend my time on. So let's have a look at the next demo. So once again, we are going over to my Teams environment. There we go. And I'm going to say I'm going to do an action. So one second. There we go. So I'm going to create an Azure resource. Now, it comes back to me saying, okay, what type of resource would you like? I'm going to say I want a storage account in this case. But I can already see, okay, which resource is actually available to me. In this case, I'm going to just say I'm going to have storage account. It's going to come back to me saying, okay, for a storage account, I need this information from you. So I need the storage account name, and I need the name for the container. I'm going to submit this. And it's now going to say, okay, thank you for your input. We are now going to actually notify your manager. So my manager will actually get a notification. There we go. So my manager actually gets a notification saying, okay, someone wants to create a storage account. Is this okay? I can say yes. And now we'll actually go out and create a storage account. So let me just grab my Teams environment. There we go. So it's now letting me know like, okay, I'm going to provision your resource. I will let you know once done. So while this is running, let's actually have a look at the backend. Not that one, this one. So first of all, I had this, when I did open that menu, I had this create Azure resource. So this is actually the option that I got. So when I chose this option, I saw this adaptive card. An adaptive card is a really easy way to create a nice UI that can you use in Teams. And that's for me, like I just said, okay, which resource do you want to create with dropdown? As you can see, I can just push some stuff on here and I can just build a very nice UI using all these resources. It's very easy to do. Anyone can just do this. It's all drag and drop. So it's really easy to set up. Now, when I got a pop-up, I selected the storage account, initialized some variables. It checks which resource type that you choose because of course, for a storage account, I probably need some different parameters than for a virtual machine. So for a storage account, I need some to get, and once again, this is a debit card. So I could just create a debit card from here, over here. I can get the code. I paste it over here. This one over here. And in this debit card, we're able to do questions like, what is the name of the storage account and what's the name of the container? Now for a virtual machine, for example, I might have to say, okay, which VNet should it be in? Which operating system should this run? For my database, it might be, do you want to use Microsoft SQL or do you want to use MySQL? Or maybe do you want to have CosmosDB? So I will ask some different questions depending on the resource I chose. I will choose the right ARM template, of course, because I'm going to deploy this. So I need to use an ARM template. I now have these variables set up. I then going to say, okay, here's your card definition. I get the input from this user. I'm then going to, once again, check, okay, which type of resource we are working with, because if I have that card for a storage account, it's different than for a different resource. So for a storage account, I'm going to say, okay, get the data from this. And then I'm going to set up this approval because I now have the name of my container and my storage account. I send out the email And I checked, okay, is this approved? When it was approved, I said, okay, create a resource group for me. I posted my message saying, okay, I'm now creating the resource group. I'm now going to actually deploy that resource. I'm using this ARM template over here. I put in the right variables. And when it's finished, I will get the finished message. Just let's have a look first at that ARM template. Because this ARM template, like I said, my operations team knows which best practice we are going to use. As a user, I don't have to know about this, but my operations team already created the ARM template for me. So they are going to create a storage account name with a unique name. And there's some stuff in here about, okay, I want to have HTTPS, for example, and I want to have encryption on this. So as a user, I don't know about these settings. Like, I don't know, do we use HTTPS traffic only? I might not even see it. Like, if I just go to the portal, I might just miss this completely. By using this template, I now know that every storage account will always be created along the same guidelines with the same best practices. Now, like I said, once it's done, it will get this finish message. So let's have a look over here because it should be done by now, indeed. And as you can see, this was just like maybe minutes. I think it takes about 1 minute or so to actually create a storage account. So I can now click on this. It will bring me to my storage account. To my resource group, I now see my storage account over here. I can open this and I can now see I have a container in here. That's actually a container I just created. And now I can start using this. So for as a user, this is much easier than having to go to all those different tickets and to waiting for my operations team to respond. This is much easier, much faster, and actually allows me to focus on the important stuff. So the last demo I want to show you is about incident management. And incident management is all about when something goes wrong and something will go wrong. In every environment, something can go wrong and will go wrong. And sometimes I've been in different clients and some clients are like this when incident happens. Maybe not this extreme, but at least like people are worrying like who's on standby? Who is the owner of this resource? Who actually knows about this stuff? Like, for example, logic apps. Who knows about logic apps? Because not everyone in the team will know about this. So who do we need to bring in to actually handle this incident? So ChatOps, once again, is going to help us here, of course. So ChatOps is going to help us by acknowledging our alarms, acknowledging our incidents much faster. Because we are going to be notified saying, hey, something is going wrong. Look into this. And we are doing this by actually bringing together the right people in this incident team. So we are going to look up who's the owner of this. And the owner will have to say, is this an incident or not? Because the owner knows if something has happened to this resource. If it's an incident, we are going to bring in the people that are on standby or the people that know about this specific type of resource. We are going to make sure that this incident team can actually focus on solving the issue instead of having to send out emails, answer questions from the company, make sure that everyone knows that we are actually looking into this. So we're actually going to do a lot of automation for them so they can actually focus on the important things. And finally, once the incident has been resolved, we are going to capture all the data and we are going to push this into a data store. So next time this happens, we can see what did we do last time. So let's have a look at incident management. So first of all, I'm going to my Azure environment. Because in my Azure environment, I have this logic app, and this is a very easy logic app and probably not quite production-like because that logic app just receives a request. And the only thing it does, it's going to check if the status is success, then I'm done. If it's not success, I'm going to terminate with a failure. Like I said, maybe not quite production production-like, but at least we have something that we can test with. So I'm just going to say over here, I'm going to call this logic app. I'm going to send in the status of failed. So when I send in this request, I'll get a 202 accepted. And if I go back to my logic app, let's have a look at the run history. And in my logic app, I'm going to receive a request. It's a request with failed. So it's going into the terminate. And it, as you can see, it actually failed with status received invalid input. Now, this is going to trigger my notifications because I have an alert on this over here. So I have an alert rule that's going to say, let me just show you. Whenever the total runs of failures is greater than one, I'm going to trigger this alert. Now, what this alert does, it's going to call a webhook. I've got one for request bin, that's for myself for some debugging. That's about this one. So I have this Power Automate endpoint. And as you can, I will show you over here, like you cannot show all, so you see all of it, but this is my Power, actually, if I do this, there you go. So you can see my Power Automate endpoint. And this is my the flow that I will show you in a minute. But so when this alert is triggered, it will call this Power Automate endpoint and will say, okay, we are going to trigger an alert for you. Now, I'm not going to wait for this because this can take up to a minute or maybe even more. So what I'm going to do, I'm going to trigger this myself. So I have the same Power Automate endpoint over here. And this is the alert that will actually be triggered from my monitor over here. So if I now trigger this, it says accepted. And now it's going to trigger my Power Automate. And if I go over here, there we go. So my Power Automate says, noticed, hey, there's an incident going on. It's going to check, okay, who is the owner of this? Which in this case, of course, is me because I'm the only person in this environment. But going to check the owner. So it's going to do a lookup in Dataverse. It's going to get the owner for this specific resource, my Logic App. And it's going to notify my owner saying, hey, we have received an alert. Can you please check? Now, as the owner, I can now say, ignore this because we are working on this resource. We are doing deployment or we know there's something wrong. So no worries. So I can just ignore it. I can notify the team saying, okay, we know there's something going on, but don't panic. Or I can actually say, I'm going to create an incident, which of course is what we are going to do now. Now for this incident, I have to enter a comment. So once again, I'm just using the date of today so we can easily recognize this later on. So I'm going to create an incident and submit this. What's going to happen next? It's going to create an incident channel. There we go. So it created this channel for this incident. And it's going to get in my team. So it's going to get in the resource owner. It's going to get in the people that are on standby. Maybe some of the people that actually know stuff about Logic Apps. So in this case, I just have the one person. But of course, you can imagine that like it will now notify 10 people. So that all have to acknowledge like, yes, we're here. And out of those 10, for example, we might say, okay, we need to at least have 5 people out of those 10 actually in there before we can continue. Otherwise, we are going to escalate this to a manager, for example. Now, I've now acknowledged this, so I now said, okay, I'm working on this incident. I know there's something going on. We are working on this and we are looking into this. Now, just by clicking acknowledge, it already pushed out a message to my general channel saying, hey, an incident is going on this Logic App, so we are looking into this. And now my team knows, okay, people are looking into this. So if we see something that's wrong, we don't have to arrest them because they are already looking into this. Now, I'm now just pushing this to my Teams environment. Of course, this could go out to emails. It could send out a bulletin. It could go out on my dashboards. In this case, I'm just pushing this to my Teams environment. Now, because you are now working on an incident, let's do some work. We are going to look into this. At some point, we might find something. And yes, I did find something because it was DNS. Because we all know it's always DNS, right? So it was DNS. So what I want to do now is notify my team, like my company, like, hey, we found something. We identified the issue. We are now working on solving it. And for this, I'm actually going to show you the backend first because there's some things that I want to show you first before we do this. So first of all, this is the Power Automate flow that I talked about previously that's being triggered for my alert. So this just receives an HTTP request. And in this HTTP request, I've got all the data about which resource and things like that. So I'm going to filter out all the information. And then I'm going out to Dataverse and I'm going to check my resource owner for this specific resource. So I'm going to check my resource for this specific Logic App, my owner for this specific Logic App. So if I go over here and show you my custom columns. There we go. So over here, I have this Logic App and I can see this is the owner of this resource. So I can now use this email address to actually call out to my owner. So I'm going to go and I'm going to loop to all of them because I could have multiple. But I'm going to check the owner. So I'm going to have the recipient on this email. And I'm going to call out the owner saying, hey, we have received an alert. So that was the notification that we saw. Now, as you can see, I've got 3 options over here. So I got ignore, notify, or create incident. If I said ignore, it's just going to go into the default one. In this case, or actually if I said notify team, it will have sent a notification to my team. In my case, I said create incident. So it created a channel, as we saw, it created a channel for this specific incident. If you have multiple incidents going on, we would have multiple channels. It's going to get my mention token, so it can actually mention me in this new channel. It's going to ask for the acknowledgement. Once again, we are using a debtor card. I'm just going to say, okay, please acknowledge, and then at that point we can continue. When I acknowledge, it would notify my team. And then there's some interesting stuff going to happen. Because from my Power Automate flow, I'm going to create another Power Automate flow. So I'm going to use this workflow definition. And for people that have worked with LogicApps before, will definitely recognize this. Because under the hood, Power Automate is actually LogicApps. Power Automate is like a nice UI over LogicApps. So make it more citizen developer friendly. So what I did, I created this workflow definition, and you can just, there are some different ways to get this. I'm a LogicApp developer myself, so I could actually create this myself. But you can also just say, I created a work Power Automate flow, and then use a Power Automate, how do you say, action. So if you look over here, Power Automate, just check. Where is it? There we go. Power Automate management. Let me just look for that one because it's a bit easier. There we go. Power Automate management. So as you can see, there's different actions that we can use with Power Automate. And what I can actually do is just say list flows. Just check list flows as admin. There we go. So I can list all the flows. And then for each flow, I can say get flow. And that will actually get me this definition that I see over here. So I added some variables, of course, because I want to actually make sure that I use the right channel so that I'm doing this on and stuff like that. And we'll see this flow in a minute, what this actually looks like. So I use this definition. I'm then going to create a flow. I'm going to create a status update flow. I'm going to use another flow. So I'm going to use another definition that we'll also see in a minute. So I'm going to create two flows. I create a status update flow and an archive channel flow. And so the one I want to show you now is this. So as you can see, when I refresh this, I now will have two additional flows. And the one I want to show you first is status update. So we just saw that whole workflow definition. And what we did in there is that we defined this flow. So when a new message is added to the specific channel, and this is why I actually had to do this dynamically, because I will want to listen on a specific channel. And what I'm going to do, whenever I have this bank status over here, I'm going to run this flow. It's going to post a message saying I want to have some information about what you want to say. And then it's going to push this into my general channel. So let's test this. Do it manually. And if I now go over here. So if I now say bank status, it will run my flow that we just saw. And at least it should. There we go, new messages. It's going to say, okay, what do you want to do? So in this case, I'm going to say we have the issue identified. It's going to be DNS. It's always DNS. I'm going to submit this. And as a user, I only had to say this bank status. And when I'm researching this, I've identified it was DNS. I just say bank status. I fill out these fields very quickly, and I'm done. And now this is being pushed out to my whole company again. So in this case, to my general channel, is pushed out, hey, we identified the issue. So now everyone in my company knows, like, okay, so they found the issue and they are now working on fixing this. So they don't have to come to my people that are actually working on this, getting them out of the flow of actually fixing this, because they can now just focus on doing this. So we now identified it, we have identified it was DNS. So we are now working on the fix, and at some point fixed by restarting. Here we go. So what fixed, we started the DNS server or something like that. So it's now fixed. So I'm now done with this incident, and I can now actually say, okay, I'm done. We have fixed everything. Everything is okay again. So I now want to clean up my whole incident report. So this channel can go, my flows can go. So what I'm going to do now is use this second one. Over here. So this archive channel. So this was the second flow that was created when my incident was created. And in the second one, I'm going to once again use this message over here. In this case, it's bang archive. So when I do bang archive, I'm going to get all the messages for my channel. I'm going to filter out the specific messages that are actually being said by people. I'm going to create a string. And in the string, I'm just going to push all these different messages. Then I'm going to create a new record in my dataverse. And in my channel history. And I'm just going to push all this, how do you say, this complete history of what was being said in the channel. And I'm going to use this later on. So when I get a new incident, I can check, okay, this logic app, what did we do last time when this has an incident? So I can actually see about the last incidents, what did we do to fix it then? So it's much easier for me to actually see what happened and how can I fix this in the, sort of the future. I'm going to delete the specific channel. So the channel that I just created, I'm going to delete now. And I'm going to delete those two flows that I created. So let's test this. Let's manually. We are going back to my Teams environment. I'm going to say now bang archive. What you are now done, everything has been fixed. And in a couple of seconds, I will actually see that this channel will be deleted. So it should, like I said, takes a couple of seconds because it triggers after, there we go. It takes a couple of seconds to trigger, then actually a couple of seconds to actually get those messages and stuff like that. But now my channel has been deleted. This channel is now gone. And if I go over here, I will actually see that my flow is also deleted. It actually tells me the flow that you provided has been deleted. So I now know, okay, my flow has been deleted. If I go back to my flows, I actually not see those two flows anymore if I refresh this. So those two flows are gone. I now only have my normal flows again, no incident flows anymore. So this has now been nicely cleaned up. Let me go over here. So like I said, I actually got all the those messages and I pushed those into my dataverse. And if I show you here my custom columns, in here you will see like there's a lot of different tests going on, lots of different messages. Of course, I don't want to give my users direct dataverse access. So what I'm going to do is actually build a Power App on top of this. Yes, sure. Get started. I should have one. Let me just grab it from here then. So we're going to edit this. So I created a Power App that's actually going to have a nice UI on top of this dataverse data. Because I don't want people to actually go into dataverse itself. I just want to give them access to my Power App. And let's hope that it actually loads a bit over here. I just want to give them access to my Power App and say, okay, let's run this. And now they can search those items. As you can see, I've got a lot of different incidents. And I can now say, okay, I want, for example, this one. So the one that we just created. I could also, of course, look for the specific logic app or for specific failure or something like that. But in this case, I'm just looking for the specific incident. I can open this. And we already see that last time, what we did, so we were looking into it, we found something. And at some point I see we fixed this by restarting. So we saw it was DNS and we fixed it by restarting. So the first thing when we have a new incident, what I do is I'm going to look for this specific resource and I'm going to check the last couple of times, what did we do? So I now immediately go, I'm going to see, okay, so last time it was DNS. Let's have a look if it is DNS now. And if it is DNS, I also have to fix because we started it. So I'm going to just restart this as well. And now instead of me having to wander around for an hour or 2 hours to try and identify this, I might be able to actually just fix this like in 2 minutes. So this may make my respond time much quicker. So with that, we are almost done. So we have seen those three different scenarios. So we saw how we can create tickets, how we can create tasks, how we can actually automate creation of branches, how we can incorporate pull requests to bring back the data into my Teams environment. We saw how we can create resources for my users by just doing drop down, filling the right fields. And instead of having to wait hours or days for my resources, I only have to wait for minutes. And we have seen how my incident management can also be done much faster by getting all this information together, bringing the right people into the group and just have them focus on that incident. So with that, let's do a quick recap. So first of all, ChatOps allows for a very powerful way of working. So you can automate pretty much all the things that you don't want to worry about, that you can just say, these are menial tasks, I'm just going to automate them away. So by using chat apps, I can just say, for example, with create resource, I could just say, create a resource for me. This is the resource. This is data. And then actually creating that resource, setting those best practices, making sure that my security is up to date, is all done for me. I don't have to think about this. It's very extensible, especially when we are using Power Platform, because you can now use Power Automate to actually call out to different services. And what we saw today, we called out to Azure DevOps, we called out to GitHub, we called out to many different environments. So we are actually going to bring out the data to them or actually pull the data back in. And finally, the Power Platform makes it so easy to actually implement this, because it just makes it much easier to actually say, I want to bring in some data from my Power Automate, or to bring in the Power Apps, or to bring in Power Virtual Agents. Anyone can use this. It's all configuration. It's all very easy to implement. So anyone can actually set this up. And we see this at clients, where just citizens and developers, so people that are just from the business, are actually setting these things up. So with that, I would like to say thank you. I hope you enjoyed the session. I definitely enjoyed being here. If there's any questions, please put them into Q&A. If not, you can always contact me later on. So the social media details are here. So if you have any questions, please feel free to contact me. And let's have a look at the different questions over here. So let me just push this up here so I can read them. So question, can you only talk with the bot in a separate chat, virtual assistant, or can you also invoke all of these commands in any general chat? So you can actually have your bots listen to any channel. So you can actually hook a chatbot up to any channel and just call this from any channel. So yes, that's indeed, like I now did not deploy this way, but I just have my chatbot myself, but you can actually do that in this way as well. So yes, that's definitely possible. And there's many tutorials out there how you can actually set this up on yourself. So I hope that answered the question. So I don't see any other questions yet. So I will wait for like one more minute for new questions to come in. If you don't have any questions right now, but later on, like I said, you can always contact me. So please feel free to contact me on my socials. And if you don't have any questions, then I would say thank you very much for being here today. Enjoy the rest of the conference. And of course, thank you all for making this happen again, because we are virtual, but at least we can still share knowledge, talk to each other on like this, and just have a good time, even when we cannot do this in person. Hopefully next time though, we can actually do this in person, and afterwards we can go together for a drink and talk a bit more about your different scenarios on there. So I don't see any more questions coming in. So with this, I would like to say thank you. I'm going to close the session and enjoy the rest of your day. Bye-bye.